right, good evening. Welcome to Business Advocate. I'm sure you're wondering why I'm here alone without any panelists to have a discussion on issues affecting the private sector of the Republic of Ghana. Now, the reason is simple and special. Recognizing the contribution of the private sector to Ghana's economic growth and development, the NIDA, with the support of USAID and the EU, set up the Business Sector Advocacy Challenge, BUSAC Fund, to enhance the capacity of advocacy of the Ghanaian private sector to enable operators to influence the, and review and implementation of regulatory instruments. The ultimate aim is to improve and make better business environments for operators in that sector. By all intents and purposes, Business Advocate has been one vital instrument and indispensable tool for advocacy by the private sector of Ghana. It is a collaboration of the BUSAC Fund, GJA, and GBC. And today marks a decade of BUSAC Fund's support to business advocacy in Ghana. A couple of hours ago, we were at the Holiday Inn Hotel to mark the 10th anniversary of the BUSAC Fund, and a lot of things happened there. We had a lot of people from the diplomatic community, diplomatic corps. We had ministers of state, stakeholders, chief executives, and all players of the private sector. And there was a dialogue also, a panel discussion, and so a lot of things went on there to commemorate the 10th anniversary of the BUSAC Fund support to the private sector or the Republic of Ghana. We just left that area. And so, in order not to leave you out, we're going to have a three-part documentary for you to be up speed with what BUSAC Fund has achieved for the private sector of Ghana through the Business Advocate that will be showing every Thursday. And what I'm going to show you tonight, actually, is about, we recorded some 8 years ago, but now that the fund is 10 years. So you're going to see certain dates that will tell that, well, it's about 2016, probably 2014. But going forward, three-part documentary to commemorate BUSAC Fund's 10th anniversary in the Republic of Ghana. Be our guest and enjoy the show. We'll see you again, God willing, next time, when we come back with our topic for the week. Till then, good evening and be our guest. Enjoy BUSAC at 10 documentaries.
The Business Sector Advocacy Challenge Fund, BUSAC Fund, has enabled businesses to thrive amidst challenges. Through the use of business advocacy, BUSAC Fund helps businesses in the private sector overcome challenges that have sought to threaten their existence.
The USAID is a partner fund to the DANIDA. BUSAC is a concept that was developed by DANIDA. And the idea of BUSAC is to just provide funds to support advocacy in the private sector. The concept was a very good one, and we joined them since 2005 when they started. We funded the first part of BUSAC 1, and we are now in the second phase called BUSAC 2.
The Business Sector Advocacy Challenge Fund, BUSAC Fund, provided over 600 grants to various private sector organizations across the 10 regions of Ghana to help strengthen their advocacy capacity.
For BUSAC Fund, we provide support not to enterprises, but the representatives of the business enterprises that know and address the key issues of their members. And for this reason, the support we provide them is to raise an advocacy issue that needed to be addressed in order to bring the changes that improves, in turn, the enabling environment of the enterprises.
Other development partners have been looking at how to support the business enabling environment in Ghana. And business advocacy was seen as one of the gaps that were to be addressed way back also, I think, some 8-9 years ago when they even started the support to business advocacy.
In our technical support in this area, one of the areas that we always get is the other support that is needed in maybe a community you're working in or with a farmer-based organization. And we thought BUSAC was a perfect opportunity for these communities to also be able to advocate for any challenges that they may be having. Because so that, if, for example, you're working with a farming group and we are helping them with technical expertise to improve their farming techniques, maybe they're having challenges in their locality in terms of access to water or access to land, then they can go to the BUSAC Fund, apply for a fund to help them advocate their local assembly to get better access rights to their land or maybe a source of a small water pump, etc.
BUSAC Fund finances through grants up to 90% of the cost of advocacy actions that are selected in each call for concept note.
In the first place, there wasn't a Tamale office, and as a result, many of the associations couldn't access the grant from Accra. And even if they accessed the grant, it was just short visits by the Accra office staff that was provided to these grantees, and it was woefully inadequate to many situations to help them achieve the results that we wanted. So after the first phase, when we got the second phase, there was a need to set up the Tamale office to provide assistance to grantees in this area and also support many associations to access the BUSAC Fund for advocacy. Within the SADA zone, we are working with 89 grantees within the three regions of the north, upper east, upper west, and northern region. We are dealing with 69 associations.
BUSAC, along with many other programs that are in place by the government, by other donors, by ourselves, I think will have a tremendous impact. In fact, we're already seeing some impact in the agriculture sector already.
I will talk about ZALDA. ZALDA is an association that is into dry season gardening, and they have a problem with damp. And with all the support we have given them today, if you go there, you will see that the damp has been worked on, and the association is happy, and this dam is not only going to benefit the association, but the entire community at large. So you can see our results, they go beyond the association level, and that is what advocacy means.
A lot of our work is trying to improve the links from farmers to markets and to access to finance, better inputs, agricultural inputs. And all these are done by different entrepreneurs, different businesses. But often those businesses don't have a real voice. They don't have a real voice in either creating policy or identifying what some of the issues are that's not permitting the market to function as well as possible. So when Danita came up with this idea of BUSAC, of providing a way for businesses to increase their capacity for advocacy, we thought it was a great opportunity to work with the private sector directly.
ZALDA is a community grouping. They form themselves into an association, and they really look out for the needs of the community as a people. And then they pursue through support. And they are really bold enough to come to assembly, go to all the areas they can find help.
When we became ZALDA, we were still working in our various groups. And then we come together and we realized that, but we had no water. And the whole group decided that that should be our key point of asking for water. And how do we ask for it? So we have to fall on our mother tracks. And they say, okay, if that's the case, you consult BUSAC to see if they can help us.
Somewhere around 2010, the members of ZALDA came up with a particular issue that has to do with the fact that a dam was started in their community and not completed under the IFA project. And so we saw it basically as an advocacy issue. And so we decided to put in a proposal to the Business Sector Advocacy Challenge Fund. And fortunately for them, they got the funding. And we decided to embark on an advocacy action to get the District Assembly and other stakeholders to complete the education gap.
Ghana Education Authority, we are the government institution that is mandated to undertake land and water resources development. In this mandate, we undertake the construction of dams, dugouts for irrigation, for livestock, and for aquaculture. Zandegu Dam was a dam constructed under Lakoset 2. Lakoset 2 is an acronym for Land Conservation and Smallholder Rehabilitation Project, second phase, which was funded by IFAD from 2002 to 2006. At the time the project ended in 2006, the Zanderobu Dam was not fully completed, but the project ended and therefore funding stopped. And therefore the project was, the embankment was half, about halfway complete. And when the project was ending, there was an agreement that in all these districts where the projects were not completed, when the project folded up, the district assemblies were expected to continue and finish. But this was not in the case for Zanderobu. The assembly didn't continue.
District assembly on our own, Babona was the chief executive of Tanesi Nabdam, couldn't push in that big money looking at our system.
In December 2010, the Zanderugu Lambumbe Development Association was given a grant by the BUSAC Fund to embark on an advocacy action christened Completion of Irrigation Dam to Boost Dry Season Farming Activities. A research was conducted to gather data on the history of the uncompleted irrigation dam, level of completion of the dam, effects on the livelihood of farmers as a result of delay in its completion. Activities were held to enhance the capacity of the selected association members of the concept and practices of advocacy to enable them effectively undertake the advocacy action. This enabled the association prepare evidence-based proposal for the action. Members of the association, as well as other members of the community, were educated on the findings of the research. The essence was to increase members' understanding of the issues so that they can effectively contribute to the implementation of the action. For the Zanderugu Langumbe Development Association, the road to success was not smooth. The association faced some challenges.
The dialogue meeting, it was really very, very difficult. It took us more than 2 months to be able to get our assembly and other duty bearers for us to have that particular, you know, dialogue meeting. Now, after the dialogue meeting, we decided to do a number of follow-ups. And the follow-ups took the form of telephone calls, sometimes personal visits to the assembly and other duty bearers, and all sort of pressure, you know.
They went to radio stations, they held stakeholders and policymakers to meetings, a lot of things. Some of the workshops I was invited.
At the end of the day, we were fortunate the dam was awarded to a particular contractor to do the completion of the dam. And fortunately for us, the money came from GSOP, that is Ghana Social Opportunities Project. Somewhere along the line, we have a Ghana Social Opportunities Project coming in. It's a project under Ministry of Local Government. So the assemblies were asked to submit proposals of them that they wanted to rehabilitate.
The GSOP begins a general rotation of all stakeholders as to what the project is about and the modes of implementation. Districts are supposed to select sub-projects from their medium-term plan, which can be done using labor-based approach. You know, GSOP, because we want to create as much employment as possible, we're using the labor-based methods or labor-intensive methods of construction. So when you see labor-intensive methods, on a scale of less than 1 to 100, you have labor, unskilled labor especially, taking about 80%, and then equipment taking 20%. So that employment is maximized, you know, to the fullest. On the average, we have 247 participants, of which 120 were males, and the remaining number being females.
The rehabilitation started in September and ended in May. So by that stretch of time, you can imagine the amount of money that has gone into the pockets of the participants.
Of course, for, you know, maintaining that dam or rehabilitating that dam was 414,000 Ghana. Out of that, 247 participants or laborers benefited. And an amount of 250,000 out of the 440 went into their pockets, which is about 50% of the total expenditure.
This dam, we constructed it. As you can see, we didn't use machines. It was constructed under our hands, our back, our heads. The community came out, and then those who came to construct this showed us how to do it. and we're getting something by the end of the day. We even work in tents. They group us. So these people will work for 1 week. Another group will come for another the other week. We're alternating until this dam, you've seen the completion of this dam.
We extract shea butter. That is not our main work. Our work is farming, but we are only using the shea butter to support the farming. So when the farming collapsed, we were suffering. Indeed, we are suffering. Now that they have constructed this dam, we are going to blend the two. In fact, we were using the shea butter as a supplement to the farming. So we are grateful to trucks that led us to BUSAC Fund. And so, we will go back to our original work, which is very good for us to support our children's education.
I will use the water to do a lot of things. When I was a young man, I used to cultivate tomatoes, pepper, onions, and a lot of things. Maybe my age will not permit me to do, but for the presence of this water, I'm thinking of doing more.
The dam has is a multi-purpose dam. It has an irrigation infrastructure which irrigates 9 hectares. Every household has livestock. Without water, they will perish. But with now water available, the livestock have water all year round. They also have the opportunity to do fishing, because then if the dam is stocked, they can engage in aquaculture. Even if it is not stocked, naturally there will be fish which they can also get, so to also augment their proteins.
All these has been made possible by the Business Sector Advocacy Challenge Fund, BUSAC Fund, with support from the development partners, namely Danida, USAID, and EU.
The communal spirit that was almost dying in the communities been enhanced following their association with BUSAC Fund. They managed to realize the need to work as a community, to plan for themselves, and then to engage the duty bearers. We wish that they will continue to do that for other communities, continue to do the advocacy role so that third needs of the communities are brought to the attention of authorities.
All our programs are focused on trying to transform the agriculture sector so that it's a sector where people are not trying to run away from, but they actually see it as a job, as a possibility to create wealth.
It was a good idea when the leader in 2004 came up with this concept about improving the business environment in which businesses operate in Ghana. There hasn't been attention on the third aspect of business, which is the business environment. You know, these businesses, you can have a very laudable business idea. You can be a good entrepreneur, but if the environment is not good, it's not conducive enough, your efforts will come to nothing.
The first phase of the BUSAC Fund, which was supported by Danida, DFID, and USAID, ended in February 2010 after 6 years of operations.
We had a very successful implementation of the phase one. And we did manage to do 362 grants during phase one. And that led into the second phase, which was supported by Danida and also USAID, and EU also came on board in the second phase of our support to business advocacy.
What we do normally is, first of all, we train the PSOs, the applicants who have been selected for support, and help them in do some evidence-based research. We would like the advocacy issue to be based on facts.
During this phase, the BUSAC Fund provided 362 grants to business groups and associations spread all over the 10 regions of Ghana to undertake advocacy activities aimed at improving the Ghanaian business environment.
What informed the leader to go into business advocacy? I think the leader has a history of supporting the grassroots level in general, and the leader is into very many public sector areas around in our developing countries, and I think if you look at it from a Pan-African perspective, they're supporting business advocacy in many countries, and we saw the opportunity to also support business advocacy in Ghana.
Business advocacy looks at issues dealing with business regulations and laws. And in trying to tackle such issues, one business entity cannot do that. It has to be a group and association, because the support they are providing is towards public good, not private good.
We have, in the second phase of BUSAC Fund, last 3-4 years, we have about 365 applications that have been approved, and many of them have been completed and are able to document successes. We do look and focus a lot on, as BUSAC Fund, on the results and the likelihood of the effects that can be derived from the support provided. And this is also part of our support and evaluation of the applicant once a PSO, a private sector organization, comes to us with a demand for a grant.
In 1969, the Ghana Institution of Engineering was officially recognized by the National Liberation Council Decree, NLCD 404 of 1969, to regulate the practice of engineering in the country.
The Ghana Institution of Engineers is a professional body, and it's a society of people who've come together with a common aim, engineers, but it also makes sure that the people who come and join the institution and call themselves engineers and practice as engineers are qualified to do so.
Our basic duty, what we do, is that we certify engineering practitioners.
The institution regularly conducts seminars and lectures and talks and things to keep their members up to date.
Currently, when we talk about members, we talk about members of good standing, that is those who are abreast with deans and the analysts, and that is close to 4,000. Female, we have a group for them, we call the Women in Engineering, one group, and as at last AGM in Takoradi in March, we were numbering just about close to 300.
In any profession, when you practice, whatever you do affects the society, and therefore when any body of people begin to recognize that the work that they do affects society and needs to be regulated and controlled, you find that people come together.
For several years, we have found out that within the country, that is within Ghana, the engineering profession or practice is unregulated. Everybody gets up and they think they understand engineering. They think they can do engineering. They open a workshop, they design, they do all sorts of things under the name of engineering. So what we've realized is that for the country to move forward, to advance, we need to regulate engineering just as it happens in other developed economies.
One of the main challenges that we faced as an institution is we have the powers that the professional bodies register.
Within the projects is executed according to what has been agreed on with the BUSAC Fund, and also to ensure that we guide the private sector organizations to do the right thing, and then also to direct them to achieve their intended success.
We have a pool of monitors, and these monitors, they are working on keeping follow-ups and checking in the field that the activities are being held according to the budget which has been provided.
The BUSAC Fund, in their own wisdom, and the development partners have asked that before you access that fund, you apply for 100% of the fund, the grant. They give you 90%, and you pay 10%. The 10% you pay shows your capacity It shows your interest.
As part of our action, we had to set up a technical committee.
We had to draw up a program.
The institution, as part of the advocacy process, conducted a survey to gather sufficient knowledge on the engineering practice in Ghana to be able to present a convincing case to government. The activities included designing the survey instrument, undertaking data collection, analyzing of data gathered, and preparation of the report on the finding. The report of the survey was then referred to the technical committee to be considered in their work.
We took the message, the PowerPoint, the presentation material around the country, and at each place we invited engineering institutions, engineering companies, members of parliament, district assembly, DCs, MCs, and all of them came in and we told them what we wanted to do in connection with the evolution of engineering practice in Ghana. It wasn't straightforward because having done the whole countrywide sensitization, one of the major areas is how to move parliament. And parliament moves under its own steam. They have got their own priorities, and getting the bill through wasn't high on the agenda. But in the long run, we also had to hold special workshops for members of parliament from the select committees to come in for us to do a presentation to them, for them also to realize and understand how the country would benefit from passing of the law.
When the bill finally did go to parliament, it had, I understand, unanimous approval. And there were no problems with it because everybody had seen the bill, had understood the bill, and we didn't have problems at all with the passage of the bill.
The law is a very, very wide law because it's been realized that there is no point in concentrating only on the engineers. They need the technicians, they need the artisans, so all of them will have to be properly trained and experienced for us to deliver reasonable and professional services.
It has come to hands to practice this law we are talking about, Engineering Council Act 2011.
This will help eliminate crack practitioners within the industry and help resolve all the structure and then the issues we'll be facing within our construction industry in the country.
Had it not been for the BUSAC Fund, it is very unlikely that we would have had the bill passed at the time that it was passed. Maybe we would still be struggling by now to get it passed.
Before BUSAC, we've been working on this for over a decade, right? But BUSAC coming in helped it by providing us with the support to do quite a lot within a limited time. And like most of these things, if you stretch it over a long period, it loses momentum.
Yeah, definitely without BUSAC, I don't know what I'll be saying about, on this interview right now. There's zero information. So BUSAC really helped, yes.
Thanks to the BUSAC Fund and the use of evidence-based advocacy, the Ghana Institution of Engineers can now execute their roles in the Ghanaian construction sector. The BUSAC Fund is committed to the creation of more enabling business environment for development and growth of the Ghanaian private sector.
Promoting this this role is the link between between the private sector at the roots, which are working day to day on a concrete basis on their production selling activities, and the authorities at the level of the district, at the level of the regions, at the level of the ministries.
BUSAC Fund is the Business Advocacy Challenge Fund, which was set up with the support of NIDA, DFID, and USAID. And the purpose of the BUSAC Fund was to establish a platform by which the private and the public sector could work together on key advocacy issues that aim at improving the business environment of the private sector?
We want to alleviate poverty. We want to focus on how can we get our support to become inclusive. We are working with the private sector, but to alleviate poverty and to support the vulnerable groups in Ghana.
We provide support to BUSAC Fund because we all agree that the future of this country, the future of economic development in Ghana, is through the development of the private sector. So BUSAC Fund has a very important role in advocacy to promote a business climate which is conducive for private sector development, which will be conducive to promote job creation through the private sector.
We have a number of steps that we have to go through. First, we have to go through training to understand why and how to advocate. The second activity is to conduct research to understand the depth and breadth of the issue. And then they either will go to the media to discuss their issue, to get public support, and then engage stakeholders.
This has empowered business member organizations, such as the Ghana Association of Medical Herbalists, GAM, to engage with the relevant stakeholders within the health sector.
The group was formed in the year 2005. It was when the first batch of the herbal medicine students graduated. Then they realized the need to come together so that together they'll be able to champion the cause of herbal medicine practice in Ghana. The big challenge has to do with the fact that after school, instead of being seen as part of the healthcare delivery system, it wasn't like that. And as a result, going out of the system became the order of the day.
Until I graduated in 2009, I realized the frustrations and the challenge outside was more.
What happened was, after meeting with various stakeholders and not being successful, we had a series of meetings with members. Prior to that, I had seen adverts in the papers by BUSAC. So upon further inquiries, we came across Smile Ghana, and they are service providers to BUSAC. So we had a meeting with them. Then it came up that they'll be able to assist us get to BUSAC to source for some funding or grant to embark on an advocacy. That will make it possible for us to meet various stakeholders involved in the implementation of the integration. So through the assistance of Smile Ghana, we're able to get to BUSAC with our proposal, and God being so good, we were successful.
It is always good to look at where the service providers are.
When a business association is given a grant, this is the first thing that is done, that you take you through the process so that you are able to advocate better. It is important to advocate to get the public sector to understand the challenges that the private sector has in going about normal business. And therefore, we go through what is it that your challenge is, how do you understand the challenge, how do you convey that challenge to the public sector, and what do you expect from the public sector to do in resolving the challenge that you have.
We're going there the militant way. Normally, we're going in numbers, and we were not ready to listen to them. So it came to a point, stakeholders were also not willing to listen to us. So after the training, per the skills and knowledge acquired, we're able to be able to dialogue with them at their level, and they also at our level, to come to a compromise. Initially, went through the background of BUSAC, then also through advocacy, what advocacy is, and why the need for advocacy and the tools needed in advocating.
With the help of BUSAC, we were taught how to, one, the various types of advocacy. We were taught that you don't get up one day and say, I'm going on a luta, but we were given the various kinds of ways to lobby. And then also, aside that, like, we were given so many things, what we must do to be able to get the attention of a leader or of someone in authority. And I believe that has really helped.
For months of sustained advocacy activities engineered by BUSAC Fund, GAM's toil in business advocacy was rewarded in January 2012. Today, members of the Ghana Association of Medical Herbalists can be found in hospitals such as the Lojokuku Krowo Metro Hospital, the police hospital, Kumasi South Hospital, Obuasi Government Hospital, as well as the Takwa Government Hospital and the whole regional hospital, to mention a few. In all, 26 members can be found at public health facilities across the country.
We have a government policy that every hospital must have a traditional medical center. Some of you have also joined with the district hospitals, health centers, to open your practices. Traditional medicine is a major and traditional medical system. The work that you are doing, it has been practiced for thousands of years.
After the BUSAC program, we had this place, and you could see that apart from the building being new, everything in it is also new.
If we talk of disease that comes to us, they are numerous, but we are guided by the standard operating procedure or the manual. Per that, we need to attend to 14 disease conditions. So if the disease condition falls outside the 14, then we need to refer you.
On average, we treat between 6 and 12 patients a day here. Our highest number has been 24. With the help of BUSAC, we've reached where we are now. Honestly, when we first met BUSAC, I thought that it was one of the numerous hypes that normally comes around. But after the program, I saw that the perception is different.
It's a very good initiative. That is why, as medical herbalists, we are all happy that herbal medicine is now integrated into the main healthcare delivery system.
The pilot services of herbal medicine came as a result of a lot of scrutiny. And it has been a long policy over 3 decades now, but if we found something good out of herbal medicine, they will be integrated. That is the base policy. Until we got the KNUSC came up with a bold concept in 2000 to train a physician assistant at a physician assistant level, someone who can at least diagnose and prescribe for common disease in some 14 to 20 areas that have been selected.
The school was established to really put scientific approach into the herbal medicine industry, and that formed the basis for establishing the department. Really, they are put through clinical training, and this is done with a number of institutions, the medical school, the confirmatory teaching hospitals, the university teaching hospital, and the pharmacology, all relevant areas, including even the social sciences. Then we take them through phytotherapy, that is after the clinical training, diagnosis and prescription. We then have to take them through the use of herbs in treatment, and that is phytotherapy. These two form the core of the course.
The BUSAC-GAM collaboration, according to stakeholders, has been very helpful.
We are gainfully employed now. At the end of the month, you'll be paid. That for us is a huge benefit. Another benefit will be that those who go into cultivation, in a way, will get employment. There will be more production of various herbal medicinal products, so manufacturers too will, as it were, get more profit at the end of the day. Then also we can decide to export whatever comes out of the cultivation. It can also serve as a means of tourism for others who are interested in medicinal plants. So for me, we have immediate benefits and future benefits.
The integration, I would have seen it by now, it would have even been dead without the support of BUSAC. BUSAC came to revive something which was dying. It was when BUSAC came in to assist the Ghana Association of Medical Herbalists to pursue the agenda of seeing herbal medicine
integrated into the health system in the country, that we began to see lights at the end of the tunnel.
When a student came out first, I think there was a whole lot of confusion, even imprisonment in the ministry. And it was the help of this collaboration that they managed to have workshops, conferences, and eventually managed to present papers to the ministry. And now, to the extent that the ministry has now accepted the herbal interns, they are graduates, praise them on a scale. Now, the district and regional hospitals are by law to establish herbal units.
The impacts are significant in terms of outcomes, and therefore is worth continuing.
In spite of these achievements, both GAM members and stakeholders believe that herbal medical practitioners could do more if their services and cost of drugs are covered by the National Health Insurance Scheme.
Everybody knows that National Health Insurance has come and it has come to stay. And herbal medicine is not included. With the help of BUSAC, as they did some time last year, we know that if they give us that resource that we need, we can cross this hurdle.
The survey we conducted at the 17 pilot places that government has initiated was that people who go for medication, most of them are National Health Insurance card bearers. And everybody is expecting to take these medicines once he's having the National Health Insurance card. But now that traditional medicine is not included in the National Health Insurance package, they are being disenfranchised, and these people usually walk away taking allopathic medicine, not to their satisfaction, because they don't have funds. That is why we are saying that for this integration exercise to move smoothly, there is the need for the inclusion of traditional medicine into the National Health Insurance package.
You see, the problem initially was that get these people integrated. But integration doesn't just mean making them visible in the hospital. It's to make them useful. But as the situation stands now, there is a high redundancy rate among medical herbalists in the various hospitals because their services have to be paid for, unlike the Orthodox members, they are Orthodox members.
We want to use this medium to plead to potential donors and BUSAC that we want to embark on another advocacy to make sure that policymakers, stakeholders realize the need to make sure that insurance covers herbal medicine service.
We think that if BUSAC could help the medical herbalists to push forward again an agenda to get their services covered by the National Health Insurance Scheme, then this process will be complete.
All these has been made possible by the Business Sector Advocacy Challenge Fund. Thanks to the BUSAC Fund and the judicious use of business advocacy, herbal medicine practice in formal healthcare system has come to stay.
It's really a concrete example of we want to see results, and with BUSAC funds we see results.
BUSAC also showed that the results that have been achieved so far is quite significant also compared to what they're supporting in other countries in terms of business advocacy. So altogether I think we're very happy with the support that has been going on so far, and we just need to continue to be very ambitious in the business advocacy area for Ghana.
The judicious use of business advocacy by a BUSAC fund with support from their development partnership, namely DANIDA, USAID and the EU, has proven beyond doubt to be an efficient and effective tool.